Then what about, I wanted to say that somebody asked before, what about the deadwood? Is really that important in a tropical forest? And where I work, that are pristine or very little degraded forests, they're not that much deadwood. But in some parts of the world, especially where there's been selective logging, deadwood can be more than 50% of the biomass that we can see. And this was in a study done in Borneo, in Indonesia, where they show that when they cut the logging, when the logging took place, they only select a few stems. That's what we call selective logging. But even this logging, they might only want the core part of the stem because, like in this case, it has the red color. So they leave a lot of wood out there. And as this wood decomposes, slowly, but eventually, it will reach the atmosphere. So it depends on which habitat you work. It might be important to also measure and consider dead wood. That's what this paper showed us. For those that are botanists, this is Bathia nitida, beautiful red wood. Next one, the soil. How do we measure the soil? So the soil is pretty straightforward. You take a sample of a known surface. That's why we use these cylinders at different depths. Then you take it to the lab to determine the carbon. And I don't know if you can see very well in this picture. In general, there's more carbon at the surface than at the bottom. Of course, because as things get decomposed on the surface where we have the litter, then we have the humus, then it mineralizes and it stays in the soil. So as you go deep, you would have less.
So how deep do you go?
This is 2 meters. Yeah? I mean, me, I only take the sample, eh? I have 2 very strong guys digging the hole for me. And it takes about a day and a half. But this was a project trying to see how it changed with the depth. Most studies that don't that do carbon, they only assess the first 30 centimeters. Sorry?
At what intervals?
It depends. In this case, we are using, for the first 30 centimeters, every 5 centimeters, because it changes more, and below that it was every 20, if I remember correctly, because it didn't change a lot. So this is just a couple of notes on the soil carbon. So the first one is that, as I said, this figure is a little bit hard to understand. Let me explain. So this is the surface, and this is as it goes deep. Eh? I think it's counterintuitive, eh? But anyway, the idea is that you have more carbon on the surface than as you go deep. And this is at 3 elevations because of what I explained, the decomposition and mineralization of carbon. The other point that it might be very interesting, especially if you work in mountain forests, is that the soil organic carbon increases with altitude. And why? This is because at higher altitudes, the temperature is lower, so decomposition is lower. So it hasn't decomposed and mineralized. So it's a lot more on the soil. And this is an example from Taita Hills in Kenya, where they show that we can see how the pH is more acidic at the higher elevations. So that also affects decomposition and how the soil organic carbon was greater. So maybe in mountain areas, your trees are smaller because of the wind and because of the cold, but maybe you have more soil carbon. So it's something you may want to consider to measure in your carbon project, to invest in measuring, because it might give you some other money. So, I mean, there's different protocols to measure carbon, and it depends not just on the carbon projects like the BCS standards, it also depends even for research different labs. So I'm going to talk about the Rainford and Afritron network and the protocols that we use, but there's some other protocols here, and there's another one that our Tanzania colleague used, the team protocol, but that one is so bad that I'm not even going to mention. Sorry. But let's just move on. So the Rainforest and Afritron network is this network of plots. Most of them are 1 hectare, but some are smaller, across the tropical forest. 3,000 plots in 42 countries, 1.5 million trees. And I just come from Congo, so we add some more trees and plots to this database. So they're very important for forest monitoring, to see, as I show you in the morning, how forests react to climatic changes. So we have the yellow ones that have only been measured once, and the red ones, that's the ones that are more interesting, that help us see how things change over time. So part of the study that I showed you before on Ghana is part of this database. So the plots were measured in 1990s, but I can tell you some of them are from the 50s in the database from the colonial times. So that helped us see how things change over time. And I just want to show you a really cool paper that came out last month, actually, by a colleague of mine working with this database. And it's not just about how much carbon do we have, but also how long it stays there. So how long do these tropical trees live and stay the carbon? And so what he did, he looked at these plots established in 1943 in DR Congo. And he remeasured 450 trees. Obviously, some already died, but those that were alive, he looked and he counted the rings and he estimated how much it had changed over time. And he classified the trees into four different groups. And some of you may know this coding system. So we have number two is understory, it gets little light. Number three is starting to reach the canopy. Number four is a canopy tree. And number five is emergent. That way it stands clearly out of the canopy. These are the biggest trees in the rainforest. And it was very interesting and rather unexpected that actually the trees in the understory were as old in average than the ones in the canopy. So for this study, they estimated that the carbon in these very tiny trees, they're about, in general, and between 10 and 15 centimeters, they were 75 years old. So they said, okay, they only have 11% of the carbon in the whole plot that we study, but actually, because they maintain this carbon for a very long time, it's very important to consider them maybe in carbon projects, because they don't have a lot, but they keep it for a long time. So it's important to preserve these little trees. So I thought it was really cool, because we always think that the biggest trees are older, and it might not always be the case. So I thought it was a really nice paper. If anybody wants, I can send a copy. So when we have these plots, we actually can assess a lot of cool things. So I want to show you two or three studies. One of them is about the effects of logging. So this study was done in Central Africa, and they used they followed the plot for 24 years. And they did two things. This was more of a forestry management idea. We cut the biggest trees for timber. And then they said, oh, wait a minute. What about if we not just cut the trees, but we also thin? So we remove some of the medium-sized trees so that the ones remaining get more sun, maybe more resources, more nutrients, more water, and they can grow bigger. Do you think it matters? Yeah? Let's see. Actually, it did matter. So the control plots, those that were not locked, were accumulating 2.5 megagrams. Megagrams and ton is the same thing, eh? Of biomass per year. The plots that had been locked, you see the gray line here, these were when they were locked, they lost the biomass, but then they recovered it pretty quick, 4.8. So they were growing faster than the normal plots. They're accumulating biomass faster. But then those that were locked and thinned, they actually gave more resources to the remaining trees, they went even faster. So, for example, in this case, for carbon, it would be good after logging to thin the plots because we are accumulating biomass faster. Of course, I must say, as I'm a botanist, that it was not all the same species. So, in terms of timber stock, the species they wanted to harvest, which in general are those that are slow growing, high timber, high wood density, so actually, it didn't make a difference. But at least if we have a carbon project, maybe it does make a difference because we are selling carbon, not timber. So just to give you an idea of the kind of research we can do. Yeah?
So, Aida, this makes it seem like we should just cut down all the forests and let them grow back.
Well, you need to be careful because I didn't say you cut completely.
Okay.
It was selective. And I think this is a very good question because if you have a forest that you selectively log, and I didn't go into the intensity of the selective logging, as it makes like little holes, the seeds of the neighbor trees will get there, or the trees that are already there will grow fast. If you clear completely a forest, how does it grow back? Are you bringing the seeds? So I think this is a very good point. So one thing is when we remove a few trees, not too many, just a few, and actually the forest reacts by growing faster or taking the opportunity of these little gaps of land or extra light or extra nutrients in the soil. But this is very different than if we lock completely the area. I can tell you nothing would be growing. And this is actually my next slide. Very good point. Yeah. So we continue with another example with the woodland. So let's move out of the rainforest. We go to the Miombo woodland of Mozambique. In this study, they were not lucky to have somebody who set up the plots 30 years ago. So they said, well, what we can do is we can find plots, in this case fallows. They wanted to see how the Miombo woodlands regenerate after farming. We say, oh, but maybe we can find farmers that can tell us the age of the place of the shamba that they farmed before, and then we can know more or less the age, and then we can put all the different ages together and kind of have a line of what happened. So this is what we call space for time substitution. And that's what our colleague from Benin was asking me yesterday. It's like, the best time to set up a plot, let me tell you, it was 30 years ago, you're already late. But first, set it now, so your children can measure, or the next group of researchers. And the other one you can do is if you can find people who know exactly the age of things, you can try to do this space for time substitution. Of course, it cannot be all over the country. You need to compare fields that are nearby, similar rainfall, similar soil type, similar fire dynamics. You cannot compare things all over. You cannot compare the fields in Rwanda that are 2 years with the fields of 5 years in Ghana. No, I think it would not be the same. But if you can find the information, you can use it to kind of estimate what would be the succession. So that's what these guys did. And actually, it's really interesting because they were interested in carbon. So they said, okay, we estimate that after about 25 years, these abandoned fields that are becoming fallows and slowly growing back to woodland have as much carbon as the natural woodland. Wow, this is pretty fast, eh? Still look at the number, 0.7 megagrams of carbon. Sorry, here is carbon, eh? This would be about 1.4 of biomass. This is a woodland, eh? Let's go back to the forest. The forest that was not even growing was already growing a lot more than this, eh? Just to have an idea. Woodland is cool, but it cannot compare to the forest. Sorry. So anyway, they were accumulating biomass pretty fast. But look at the soil. 30 years later, no change. This is the natural woodland. This is the amount of carbon in the soil in the first 10 centimeters. Nothing had changed. So one of the points of the story is that if we have a carbon project, especially a restoration project, yeah, we can plant trees or we can let them grow. But to restore soil carbon takes a very long time. Okay? And also the biodiversity did not recover. The same thing, carbon recovers faster in terms of total numbers than does species. These are species that are slow growing, usually shade bearers. They don't like the sun. They usually come later in the succession. So they might look like we have the same amount of carbon, but the species are different. And maybe the benefits that it derives to local communities are also different because of the different species. So another example, this time from Gabon. This is the savanna and forest succession. And I always think it's very interesting because me, I worked more in West Africa before, and there the problem is that the savanna is eating the forest because of more fires. But actually in Gabon, they have the opposite problem. The forest is eating the savanna. So I thought it was very interesting. That's why I want to show you this study. So in this area, we have the savanna. And the tree, as I said, the little seeds fall in and they start growing in this area, and over time it will become forest. So how fast these forests grow and how fast the different types of forest grow? So these are the numbers. So I think it's important to see here, okay, all types of forest, this would be the savanna zero, colonizing, few trees, monodominant, mostly one type of species, marantase, and then the old growth to compare with. So yeah. Over this 20 period of time, they all accumulated more biomass, but the rate of accumulation was not the same. The young ones, 3.8.